Now, Mapua University and Malayan Colleges Laguna just launched a digital-first college offering a flexible learning experience to students in the field of business and technology. The Mapua Malayan Digital College will start holding classes this August, and joining us this morning is MMDC's Chief Learning Officer, Derek Latrell. Derek, good morning and congratulations.
Hi, Mimi. Thanks. Appreciate it. Appreciate being here with you.
All right. So you say digital first. How is that different from what most schools have been forced to do, hybrid, digital, and in-person, hopefully when allowed? I mean, what does digitally first mean? Is it 80, 90% of all tests or projects or classes done virtually?
Yeah. Well, what we do is we look at the hardware and the software and we say we have to make this work. Instead of just using Zoom or something, we've got to use a software stack that's designed for distance learning. And we use a project problem case-based model. So it's designed to be online, but it's designed to be engaging and interesting. And we say digital first because the second thing is we do have student centers that you can go to and meet up with other students.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So why don't you share with us some cutting edge technology that you will be using for this setup and how, example, how can it better teach, you know, concepts like developmental math or precision medicine, for example, things like that? How can tech do this better?
Sure. Well, what you've got to do is it's honestly the tech is enabling the real work. What you have to do is you have to give students real work. We learn through doing, right? And so the projects, problems, and cases, the tech enables an environment where that real work is possible. When we do the projects, problems, and cases, we get the students to encounter the areas of reasoning and the areas of decision making that are the things that companies, the Ayala companies, the Yuchenko companies, these kind of companies, we've listened to them, we've talked to them, and they've said, this is what we need from graduates, is more of this, more of the conceptual causation thinking, more of logical deduction. So it's not about setting up something in the metaverse, but it's rather about setting up a distance digital capability for students to work on projects, problems, and cases together, face to face, at a distance, in their homes, all those kinds of things. It's about having tools like we have one partner called Engagely, where instead of just meeting in a Zoom meeting and the professor talking, students are able to go into different groups and work on those projects within our platform, and the professor is able to move through those different groups and look at how they're doing on their projects. It's specifically designed for collaborative education.
Collaborative education. Could you give us a clear idea how an education from this college will work out? It's going to follow the trimester of Malayan colleges, I know. So three semesters. And then how much of the classes will be done digitally versus in person?
Yeah. So what typically happens with a typical class, one single class, you have 54 contact hours, right? What we're going to be doing is we'll be meeting about 1.5 hours a week, one time a week with students for that synchronous engagement, right? So less than usual. But then what happens after that? Well, there's all these on-demand tools they can pull, on-demand electronic books. You don't even have to buy books at our school. You get them electronically. Electronic books, electronic video, all this kind of stuff. Any information you need to gather, that's all on demand. And then you can go down to the student centers, that we call them learning hubs, you can work on those projects, problems, and cases with your fellow students. So learning's done at your house, grandma's house. It's done at the student center. It's done at the coffee shop. It's done online, offline. That's why we call it digital first, because it's digitally enabled, but it's everywhere.
It's everywhere. Okay. I know that you describe this college as, you know, not having the typical lectures, not having the typical tests. Will this mean that you might be using a different baseline when you evaluate the students' capacity? And when students graduate from your course, will they be at par with others who went through the more traditional route? Is it going to be apples to apples? And more importantly, will the diplomas you give be universally accepted like every other diploma from accredited CHED schools and honored by employers?
Yeah, well, let me respond to the last thing first. Okay. So absolutely, the degree type is a normal BSBA or a normal BSIT degree from Malayan Colleges Laguna. That's your degree is the same as any other degree that CHED would approve and allow us to grant. And Chet's okay with this. The Commission on Higher Education has made provisions for outcome-based education. So this fits within their respices. And in terms of what industry wants, that's what we're really dialed into. We've got an instructional design team that's talking with industry people all the time on identifying what are these thinking capabilities beyond skill, underneath that, what are the thinking capabilities that are missing in graduates? Because we have lots of graduates in the Philippines, but we have a lot of unfilled jobs. And the difference is, the gap is, it's thinking capabilities, it's decision-making capabilities. So I'll give you another example, like effectual thinking, which is about persuasion, getting those kinds of things that are built in. So you're going to learn about economics, but you're going to learn how to persuade someone to invest in your business because of the great economic plan.
Mm-hmm. Derek, I'm very curious. This is essentially an ed tech play. Would you say it is? An education play? Is it an ed tech play?
That's a good question. We didn't invent any technology, but we've assembled the best technology that fits the context of the Philippines.
Okay. Before we get to your actual college, I wanted to ask you, because, you know, some people say that we are in the great experiment, the grand experiment in the last 2 years, 1.6 billion students all over the world forced to shift to online distance learning or hybrid during the pandemic. Is there data, Derek, that shows us how effectively, efficiently we've done the transition? Because there are worries that this generation of students are going to be part of a lost generation. Because when you think about it, this online learning, it's very easy to think something must be falling through the cracks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's true. We spent 2 years planning and building this, and there's a reason, because it's not easy. It's not easy to build really great distance education. And, you know, just taking a professor and saying, hey, jump on Zoom and provide your lecture, it does leave a lot to be desired. As for the data, it's rolling in. We don't have longitudinal data on the educational impacts yet. Sadly, what we have is we have a lot of data about the psychological, emotional effects on students. It's been pretty rough. It's been very rough on them. And that's why we think you gotta still get those students together online and offline, both, so that we can avoid those impacts, because that alone has already been difficult enough.
Mm-hmm. Will going digital first be able to address the dropout crisis? I mean, what will it mean? There might be fewer dropouts, better success rates for the students?
We think so. And here's why. We're taking a brand heritage that's well known, a very good brand heritage. We're making it more affordable. We're bringing it near you in price. And why do a lot of students drop out? They drop out because they're struggling to afford it. Right. So that's a big part of the dropout rate. And we've included Wi-Fi in it. There's not extra costs outside of our fees. And so we've tried to make sure that it's a very affordable and you can get the BUCOS program in order to extend your payments. So we think we're working to solve that. And people are price sensitive in this recovery. Right. So we hope we can definitely lower those rates of dropout.
And by lowering rates of dropouts, you're making it more affordable. How affordable is education for this digital first college?
Yeah, well, you're going to be able to $60,000 a year, including your Wi-Fi, and we can even get you a device if you don't have one, laptop, a Chromebook, so that you're able to have the equipment you need to successfully do this. You don't have to try and do it on your phone or your dad's old tablet.
Okay, $60,000 looks doable. That's $20,000 per semester. For a trimester program. Will it also mean, digital first, will it also mean much more personalized, adaptive program with immediate feedback, dramatically enhancing productivity? Will this enable, you know, students to see with greater clarity, for example, how what they're learning can translate to earnings, how what they're studying can help with employment? Can they make that connection faster?
Absolutely. Yeah. Professors are going to be relieved from having to lecture because all that's on demand, right? So then professors really engage with small groups and coach. They turn into coaches. That's really cool. That's a cool engagement instead of a boring engagement. And so students are going to feel like my professor's coaching me through something real. I'm being evaluated on what I produce, just like it would be at work. And what are they going to be producing? I mean, from the first term in BSIT, you're going to be coding. So we're going to be doing the work that you do in the real world.
Mm-hmm. And are the professors ready for this? for this digital first? Everyone's been used to the, you know, the old school traditional way of learning and teaching. Are the teachers ready?
Well, we have a 2-month onboarding process just to bring them up to speed to that. There's no question that getting used to our you know, this tech stack we built that really, but we've got a great tech team that's made it easy for professors and easy for students. It's hard for the tech team, but it should be easy for professors and easy for students. And then it's just getting used to how to use all those tools that should all be single sign-on integrated, all those kinds of things. So, we try to make it as easy as possible on the tech side. Now, can you then adapt to your role of facilitating projects, problems, and cases? That's the key.
All right. And of course, you are part of the Yutchenko Group of Companies. What sort of synergies can students and the parents of these students expect from this kind of education coming from you guys?
Yeah, well, that's the great part. When we need to figure out, you know, when we're looking at operations management majors and we want to know, okay, what skills do operations management majors need? We're able to go right into Yutchenko Companies, talk to great operational managers, download from them the kind of thinking that's involved. That's what our instructional system design team does, is to pull that information together. We have a lot of friends. The Yutchenko Group of Companies has a lot of friends in the business world, so we're able to talk to lots of companies, not just those, and really figure out how to connect education with industry. I think that's where we got to lead in bridging this industry academe gap, right?
This connection, does it include or involve internships at various Yutchenko companies?
Yeah, there will absolutely be internships there. We have our last term of the year with us is a very intensive program of readiness. And we connect you with a career placement services officer whose job is to work with you to get a job, help you go to interviews, help you dissect those interviews. We send you to our affiliate companies to interview so they can call us up and say, here was the feedback on this guy. He was good, but he needs to work on this. That's pretty unique.
Unique. Sounds like a good plan for when, you know, students get back on the saddle here. Derek, thank you so much for joining us this morning, for sharing this very exciting venture, education. Education is really key to the future, truly.
Thanks, Mimi.
All right. Thank you.